Yes, good evening, students. Today we are going to see the rapid revision round on biodiversity and conversion. Yes, a very warm good evening to Harish, Jivita. Yes, we are going to start this interesting session on biodiversity. Like, we are going to have the next 30 minutes of very informative come interactive session. I hope students, you will all enjoy this. Let us start beginning with the session. Let me move on to question one. The trees occurring in two seasons is the characteristic feature of temperate deciduous forest, tropical savanna, grassland, coniferous forest. The trees occurring in two seasons is the characteristic feature of which of the option? Yes? Which of the option? Temperate deciduous forest, tropical savanna, grassland or coniferous forest? And we know that there are various biomes, right? And in that, which among this we find? The trees occurring in two seasons is a characteristic feature of? Yes, it is the temperate deciduous forest. See, temperate deciduous forest, when you take, okay, actually is a biome where we have those deciduous trees, like leaf shedding. Leaf shedding, that is in autumn. That is, we'll have that four seasons, you know, that classical you can find in this temperate deciduous, like winter, spring, summer, okay, autumn, all that you will find it in the, okay, you will find it in the temperate. Yes, excellent, ma. Very good, Jivita, Akshaya, Harish. Yes, you have given the right answer. Yes, you will find it in the temperate deciduous forest, because these forests, like where you see that four distinct seasons present, the diversity of trees and species are also very higher. And as like when it becomes like when you move near to the mountainous, no, you will come across with an array of soil types and all that. So here these forests, no, they have a lot of broad leaf forest. They have those wide flat leaves. So this is quite mid-latitude area of the earth, that is between the tropics and the Arctic pole, in between, like you find this temperate deciduous forest. So that is the right answer. Beta diversity is diversity, option one, in a community, between communities, in a mountain gradient, on a plain. So where is the beta diversity seen? Actually, this concept of diversity, that alpha, beta, gamma diversity, was given by R.H. Whittaker. He was the one who introduced these terms. So what is alpha? Yes, Tirisha, welcome. You have given the answer. Good. What about alpha? Alpha will denote only the local species pool. What about the gamma? It is the diversity that is present in a range of communities. Actually, alpha and beta, that gives you this gamma diversity. So the overall thing will be given by the epsilon diversity. Now, what is beta diversity? Yes, you children are right. It is between the communities. So beta diversity is between the communities. So between the communities. So it is a ratio of the regional and the local species diversity. So between the communities is what? It is called the beta diversity. So this question is very important. Like, they can ask you, like, who proposed this, or what is the other types of diversity. So these are all going to be the other set of questions associated with beta diversity. Yes, very good, Tirisha, Akshaya, Jivita, Harish. Very good, Harish. Everybody, excellent. Which one of the following is a pair of endangered species? Garden lizard and Mexican poppet, rhesus monkey and salt tree, Indian peacock and carrot grass, hornbill and Indian aconite. So what is the endangered species? First, you should know like what is endangered species. Endangered species, they are categorized by the IUCN as the red list. Like those are the species which is going in for extinction. That is, they are just getting disappeared from this world. So the those species with that lower population or they are becoming extinct, we call them as endangered species. So among this, so in our India, like not only here, various places in the world, they have made a list of those endangered species and they are going to preserve or they are going to conserve the either it is a plant or an animal. So that is where. So see, hornbill and Indian aconite. Okay. Yes, very good, Harish. Indian the aconite, they are the endangered species. Okay, so that you have to know. Excellent, ma, very good. We'll go to the next question. So the next question, see here, the Indian hornbill and the Indian aconite. See, the probable reason is they say that it could be because of various causes they put forth with the loss of this biodiversity or extinction of certain species, like in terms of habitat fragmentation or in terms like always we are being blamed, the men, because of his resources he started exploiting this, and that is why there is a loss of these endangered species. Because once when their habitat is getting fragmented, definitely what will happen, these species don't have space. Okay, they don't have real space where they have been put up in. So that is why all these issues are creeping up. So it is the need of the hour, like global warming or greenhouse effect or in terms like conserving the biodiversity. All these are all like something very edge of the thing, like where we have to really think over it. Okay, so that is the solution. Which of the following plants is an endangered species in India? So here we are talking about in India. Lycopodium species, Spinus roxburghii, Hydrilla, Cedrus deodara. So what should be the answer, ma? Yes. So what should be the plant, like when you see those pines and all, no? Like they are more confined with this Himalayan. They are called the Himalayan pines. Okay, so they are not the endangered species list. The Hydrilla is that aquatic plant. Okay, so they don't have. Cedrus deodara is not in the endangered list, whereas Cedrus atlantica is there in the endangered list. So this also cannot be there. So it is the Lycopodium species. The Lycopodium species, like you can see those ferns, no? I hope you, like everywhere we can see. What happens, that is becoming more endangered species in India. Because people as a part, like they want to burn up, no? Once after they finish their routine part of their agriculture, as they burn up, these ferns, everything, they are getting destroyed up. So that is why there has become a big threat to these ferns. So that is why they have been put in the endangered species list. So the answer is excellent. Harish, very good. Akshaya, Shreya and Jeevita, the answer is Lycopodium species. Very good. Okay. We'll go to the next question. Which of the following is considered a hotspot of biodiversity in India? Indo-Gangetic Plain, Eastern Ghats, Aravalli Hills, Western Ghats. So among this, which is called the hotspot of biodiversity in India? Which is the one? Yes, excellent. Students, please do answer. Yes, I'm waiting for you all. Please do post the answer. Yes, you are giving the right answer, ma. Yes, excellent. This time Shreya gave up the answer. Okay, then the answer is actually the Western Ghats. See, you are having what are hotspots. See, hotspots are the regions where they are going to be rich in biodiversity, like in terms of flora and fauna. That is, there will be species richness. Particularly, they will have those endemic species, like whatever that is confined to that particular local region. Now, in these places, there has been a threat, probably because of either the direct or indirect interference by the humans. So this is where those species are becoming extinct. They say that Western Ghats and all, no, they have got a very vast array and type of species of amphibians, they do say. So it is around some 1600 kilometer, ma, which will range from this Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, right, Kerala, till this, and it can even extend up to Sri Lanka also. So this much peak is that what is that, the Western Ghats. So the Western Ghats is considered to be the hot spot of biodiversity. Next to Western Ghats, like we consider the Northeast. The Northeast is the next. Then comes the Indo-Gangetic Plain. So the Northeast is the next highest place where we have the hot spots here in India. Okay, very good. Yeah. Which is referred to as the lungs of the planet Earth? Western Ghat, Lake Victoria, Greenland, Amazon rainforest. Which is called the lungs of planet Earth? It's a very simple, very, very simple question. Let me see who gives the answer. Yes. Excellent, Harish. Very good, Harish. Yes, the answer is what? It is none other than the Amazon forest. See, just we are taking you now inside the Amazon forest. See, right? We are giving you a visual treat also. Okay. Only you can have all these treats in your biology class. See, we are taking you now inside the Amazon forest. See, this Amazon forest, see, I am taking you all here. It is located in South America. It's a tropical rainforest. Okay. It is nearly around some 2.1 million square meter. Okay, here more than half the world species of plants, animals, everything are there. So here what they are going to do, they are in turn going to consume all the carbon dioxide and they are going to liberate the oxygen. So this is where the Amazon rainforest has been tagged or labeled, or we have crowned them to be called the lungs of the planet Earth. Yes, excellent students. Okay, coming here to the next question. The population limited to a particular geographic area is called as pandemic, endemic, alien, natural. What you call that particular population which is limited to a particular geographic area? Yes. Yes, it's a very simple question. Yes, the answer is endemic. That is, endemic means what? Like suppose, for example, you take a plant or an animal, like they will be restricted to that particular place. That we call it as endemic. Like for example, the best I always say is the glacier bear. Okay, where they will be mostly confined to Southeast Alaska. So they are endemic for that particular region. So the answer is endemic. So endemic species, they will have that restricted geographical in a particular area in a given time, that restricted distribution. Like for example, we have this Nilgiri tar, the Kashmir stag in Kashmir Valley. So these are all are the endemic species. Okay. Yes, very good. Next question. The largest tiger reserve in India is Nagarhol, Valmiki, Nagarjuna Sagar, Sri Sailam, Periyar. So where you have the largest tiger reserve in India? So see, from biodiversity question, it will be like, ma'am, what is this? Like, it looks like a general knowledge sort of discussion. Like mostly the questions will come like this only, like where you find the largest or which is the first tiger reserve that has been put up in India, like what is the name of the tiger reserve, because in biodiversity chapter the main is what, conservation of all these things, right? So they will be very particular, they won't go probe very deep into it, but at least the main important sites and hotspots or what you call the sanctuaries and thing, you have to have an idea about the place where it is located, what species are they conserving there. All these things are the very important thing that we used to ask in the biodiversity chapter. Yes, I think people are giving up the answers. Akshaya has given Nagarhol, but the answer is Nagarjuna Sri Sailam. So Nagarjuna Sri Sailam is actually the largest tiger reserve in India. Okay, so it is located in Andhra Pradesh. Now it's part of the Telangana state also. Whereas this Nagarhol, that is actually a tiger reserve only, but it is located in Hosur, Karnataka. Achha. What about the Valmiki tiger reserve? It is located in Bihar. Periyar is located in Kerala, Idukki. where it is not only famous for tiger, even you have elephants also. Okay, so that way it gets the credit there. So you people should know about like the reserves, where is the species that is found, all that is only from the examination perspective they will ask you. Yeah, we'll go to the next question. One of the ex situ conservation methods for endangered species is wildlife sanctuaries, biosphere reserves, cryopreservation and national parks. So what are the ex situ conservation method? Like what is ex situ conservation method? See, I told you already there is a threat to the biodiversity. Yes. So to conserve, we have two options. One is called the in situ, another one is called the ex situ. So when I say in situ method, we are going to conserve the species in that natural habitat like national park or sacred groves like that. Okay, now what about ex situ conservation? Like you are going to preserve those biological species outside the natural habitat. Okay, like in the form of the gene bank. Okay, or it can be like cryopreservation or seed thing. Yes, you're all right. It is the cryopreservation. See, this is how we will be having those cryopreservation deep refrigerators where we will be storing the endangered species gene, or it can be what you call the explant or the cell of it, the totipotent cells, whatever it is, whatever that we need, everything will be stored up here so that for the tissue culture and all that. So ex situ conservation is a method by which we select the plants or animals which is outside their natural homes. So like cryopreservation or other things are all like bioreserve or wildlife sanctuary, all these are all, or what they are all, in situ conservation method. Only this is ex situ conservation method. So by doing like this, later by using the recombinant DNA technology or by tissue culture, like where we can process with the development of those, or we can conserve those endangered species. Okay, next. India has only 2.4% of the world's land area, but its share of the global species diversity is option A 1.8%, 3.1%, 5.1% and 8%. So how much is the share of the India in the world land area is 2.4, and how much it is going to share with the global species diversity? Yes, this is a very direct question which is directly given in your NCRT itself, right? So you need not even think of it. Excellent Shweta has started giving the answer. Let me see others how they are giving the answers. Yes, Akshaya. But the answer is actually 8%, ma. It is around 8%. Okay, see, India has got the 2.4 of this world's total area with 8% of the global diversity. Okay. So we have got so much of species, roughly say around some 1.75 million species. That is why we are contributing that 8%. Even though the space is less, we contribute for how much? 8% of it. That is why among the 12 mega biodiversity areas in the world, India is also included one among them, right? So that is the reason. Okay. So Akshaya, Jeevita, Shweta, you are all able to follow? Yes. We'll go to the next. If the high altitude birds become rare or extinct, the plants which may disappear along with them are pine, oak, orchards, both A and B. So as these high altitude birds, they are slowly, because we know that the pollination is through entomo. There's one thing called ornithophily. I hope you know what is ornithophily. It is a pollination through birds, right? So once when the birds become extinct, what are the plants that is going to get disappear along with them? Okay. Excellent. Harish has given the right answer. It is the oak. See, the oak plants, okay, they may disappear probably because they are totally dependent on the pollination. It's not like pine or orchids. They have other modes, but oak is totally dependent upon the pollination through birds. If they are going to become extinct, definitely the oak will become extinct. And another one thing also they will ask in the exam, children, that is called the rhodo please, if you have a notebook or something, please take it down. This is another additional information I'm giving you. The rhododendrons is also another type of plant that is also totally depend upon the orthonophily. Okay, so they are present at very, very high altitude, say around some 12,000 to 16,000 feet on the east and western Himalayas. Okay, suppose that high altitude they are present. If suppose the birds become extinct, these also will become rare and extinct. So that is where you have to know about these rhododendrons also. Okay, good. Yes, it is the oak tree. Okay, next question. Which part of the world has a high density of organism? Deciduous forests, grasslands, tropical rainforests, savannas. So among this, which has got the high density of organism? I'm just looking for your answers, children. Yes. Yes, very good students. Yes, very good Shweta. Yes, I could see people giving the answers. Yes, excellent ma, very good. It is none other than the tropical rainforest. See, now we are all taking you. See, the real treat, okay, for the eyes. Okay, only the subject biology can fetch you, where all your five senses, where you can feel the essence of the subject, and that is biology, that comes the medicine also. So here, the tropical rainforest, you see, that has got the high density of organism. So what are those tropical rainforests? Okay, they'll be quite near to equator, they've got a high density of organism. Okay, they are found in America, South America, Congo River Basin of Africa, Southeast Asia and all that. Now here, you have to understand that nearly 70 to 80% are all insects, 80 to 85% are birds. Okay, some nearly 200 species of trees are there. So this biome has got more than half that of the flora and fauna of the world. So the productivity is so high. That is why this has got the such a high density of organisms. Okay, that is the reason. Okay, next, coming to the 13th question. Tiger is not a resident in which of the following national parks? Sundarbans, Gir, Jim Corbett National Park, Ranthambore. Where you don't find tigers? Yes, it's a very easy question, children. Where you don't find the tigers? Yes, I see everybody giving up answers, like Shweta, Sirisha, Jeevita, Akshaya, Harish. Yes, I want you all to come up. Please start giving answers. Whether you're right or wrong, that doesn't matter. Involvement and interaction is important. Only when you learn, when you make mistake, that means you will not make mistake in your NEET exam there. Here, a participation is important. I want you all to participate. So tell me, tiger is not a resident in which of the following national parks, ma? Okay, let us see about Ranthambore. Ranthambore is actually located in Rajasthan, and it has got, it's one of the tiger national park it has got there. What about the Jim Corbett? It is present in Uttarakhand, right? Uttarakhand. Okay, it is also the first tiger national park. I hope you all would have studied in your English prose about the Jim Corbett lesson, right? Yes. What about the Sundarbans? Yes, that is also the tiger which is located in West Bengal. Okay, what about the Gir? Yes, that is the option. The Gir national park, no? That is located in Gujarat. Look at the lion. It's an animal which has got that characteristic attitude, the way which it carries itself. I just love lions. So you can see the Gir National Park, okay, where it is situated in Gujarat. So this national park is not for the tigers, they are meant for the Asiatic lion. Apart from lion, we have other species also. See, panther, hyena, sambar, nilgai, chital, all that. Sambar is like a deer, it's not that sambar we make for Italy. Okay, so these are other species that are also located in this Gir National Park. Okay, so that should be your answer. Yes, excellent. I think all the students started putting up the answers. Good, excellent ma, very good. All of the following are included under in situ conservation except. So we saw there's one ex situ we asked. Now here we are asking you with one in situ. So I told you what is in situ and ex situ already explained. Now you are going to make it up. What is that exception? Whether it is a national park, sanctuary, botanical garden, biosphere reserve. Okay, all the following are in situ. Except, what is that except? Yes? So we know those national park or sanctuary or biosphere reserve, they are all in situ conservation. What about the ex situ? The ex situ conservation is that you are going to preserve the components of those species which is outside their natural habitat, like having zoos. We are having Vandaloor Zoo, right? Or we have those aquariums or botanical gardens, those gene banks like cryopreservation or tissue culture, seed banks. So they're all the best examples. But what about those wildlife sanctuaries or biosphere reserves or the national parks? They are all in situ conservation, whereas the botanical garden is an ex situ. So which should be your answer? It is the botanical garden. I'm sorry, it's a botanical garden. Yes, excellent ma. I see Harish, Sweta, Murugan, Rohan has come. Good. Srisha, Jeevita. Okay, they're all giving up answers. Excellent. Yes, let me see. We'll move on to the next question. Good, good. Tectonic is a study of volcanoes, earth crust, sand dunes, sun. What is tectonics? Tectonics is actually what? Tectonics is what? And what is it is meant for? Tectonics. Yes? What is tectonic? Yes, tectonic is nothing but it's a study of the earth crust. Okay, actually earth is only made up of those tectonic plates, right? I hope you'll heard about, there are so many plates, right? They are nothing but those tectonic plates. Actually, by knowing of the tectonic plates, no, it's very important for you to understand about that soil erosion, they say. And even you have to know about those tectonic plates, because that will give you about the idea of the places like where there is more prone for developing those earthquakes, those volcanoes and all that, right? So for that, like that will affect the global population. So tectonics is a study actually, where they study about the earth crust. Okay, so that should be your answer. I think Shweta is very good. She started giving up answers. Good, good. Harish, Sirisha, Jeevita and all. Good. Okay. A keystone species is one that has a higher likelihood of extinction than a non-keystone species, contributing to ecosystem properties, causes other species to become extinct, has a weak influence on an ecosystem. So what should be your answer? First, you should know like what is keystone species. Keystone species means in an ecosystem is something that is exerting a very important regulatory effect. Like it is meant to have a very strong influence on the ecosystem. Okay, so that is, it contributes to those like in terms of enhancing the species and removing the competitors which is there. So that is to do with the keystone one. It has got a weak influence on an ecosystem. No, that cannot be the option. Or it causes the other species to become extinct. No, whereas contributing to the ecosystem properties is a keystone species. Or likelihood of extinction will not be there. So what should be your answer? It is a keystone species will always contribute to a stronger influence on the ecosystem. It will have a contributory property for the ecosystem. So that should be your answer. Okay ma? Yes, very good. Rohan has already given the answer. Excellent. Yes. Jeevita and everybody. Good. Yeah. I'll just make a small change in the date here. Okay, now we are going to match column 1 with column 2. Okay, World Forestry Day, World Animal Day, World Habitat Day, World Environment Day. Here there are list of dates given like October 4, June 5, March 21st, October 5th. So what should be our option? Yes. Harish, you are talking in terms of the biomass. There we are talking in terms of the species. That is the species which is going to have that regulatory effort on other species in the community. Okay, so that is where we describe a keystone species. You are talking in terms of the biomass, so that is different. But what you are saying is biomass is on less influence, right ma'am, on ecosystem you are asking, right? Even the biomass, we can't say it has got less influence. Even it has got an influence with the ecosystem also. We can't just like that omit a biomass. Biomass also is very much needed. Okay. So now just to match this column with column 2, ma, what is the World Forestry Day? It comes on March 21st. What about the World Animal Day? It comes on October 4th. World Animal Day is on October 4th. What about the World Habitat Day? It is on October 5th. And World Environment Day, it comes on June 5th. So your answer is excellent. Harish, Akshaya, Jeevita, all they are just bombarding with answers. Excellent students. You are all at where level? Good, good. Very nice to see you all like this. Good. See, certain dates, that is why we wanted to emphasize certain questions. You might ask, ma'am, it's all very simple. But when you go to the exam, no, you will have the feel like what date is what, because we don't even remember our own birth dates. Okay. So that is why. Okay. That is a reason that you need to know. So those some common dates are there. So I wanted you students to know the days and the dates. Definite 1-4 marks is there in your pocket. Read and go. So this chapter, like, you have more of what you call logic thinking. Like, you have to have so many things on your fingertips, and from here you get some questions and where you have those marks in your hands. So like that, prepare this biodiversity chapter. That's how it's thing. And the people doing biology should not have the fear of memorizing or remembering things. Hope so. Okay, coming to question 18, which of the following is not a criterion used for determining the hotspots? Or not a criterion. Always I have given you the clue how to read a statement. Okay, so the option 1, number of endemic species, degree of habitat destruction, having traditional strategy for production of biodiversity, degree of exploitation. So what should be your answer, ma? Yes, Harish, Rohan, Tirisha, Akshaya, Jeevita, like attendance, I am calling you every time. You people should come out with answers. Let me see. Whether it's right or wrong, please do post. See, when I say hotspot, I already said, see, what is that? We have got a very rich biodiversity, but whether because of direct or indirect influence, these humans are exploiting it. So there is a loss of biodiversity. So what has happened? We are going to conserve them in the form of hotspot. When I say hotspot, it has got two major criteria. One is the species richness. The other one is in terms of endemism. Like those endemic species will be very high in that particular area. Okay. So like that, we have nearly around some 34 hotspots, right? And whatever that land area, even that required will be very less. But when you take certain countries, okay, that much amount of resources are not available to make lot of hotspots or biodiversity areas. So that is one. So what are the criteria that we take? See, the criteria, they are saying not a criteria. Now first one, number of endemic species. We said hotspot determines with the endemic species. So this cannot be our answer. Degree of habitat destruction. Yes, wherever there is habitat destruction, we want to stop that, put a full stop for it. So this also cannot be there. Or having a traditional strategy for protection of it. We cannot have a traditional strategy which will not work out in conserving the hotspot. So this should be your answer. Degree of exploitation. Yes, wherever you find those exploitation, we want to make it a stop and make it a place of hotspot. So that is a main criteria. So this will not be your answer. So this is your answer. Okay. So I hope Devanandam Payam, he has given the right answer. Others, you are all able to follow, like, why did I choose this? See, in a hotspot, the endemic species is more, which I already told you. But why should I go and preserve or make that place a hotspot? Like, because there is more of destruction, there is more of exploitation, I want to put a full stop for it. That is, they are the criteria for tagging as a hotspot. Okay, so what is not a criteria here? I will not use a traditional strategy method for protecting the biodiversity. Okay, children, you are all able to follow? Yes. Yes, that is the answer. Okay, next, nice. We are going to match column 1 with column 2. Let us see what is what. Silent Valley, Rhinoceros, Tiger Project in Karnataka National Park. Here we are going to match with Kaziranga, Bandipur, in situ, Tropical Evergreen Forest. So let us see what is going to match with column 1 and column 2. Yes, children. Yes, let me see who gives the answer. It's a very easy question. Yes. Okay, let me have some small general ideas. Like whenever, if I am a student like you, what I will do immediately, I know this rhinoceros, like I have my geography teacher and all have taught me well. So rhinoceros is with Kaziranga, this I know ma. Karnataka with Bandipur I know. National park is something with in situ. So definitely that Silent Valley is nothing but with tropical evergreen forest. Yes, you children are right, it is option 4. Very good. I see Rohan, Tirisha, Harish, okay, and Jeevita giving up answers. So you are able to follow ma. See, A, Silent Valley is not with Bandipur ma. It is in Karnataka. It is a Tiger project. Silent Valley, tropical evergreen. What about rhinoceros? Kaziranga, Assam. Tiger project, Karnataka, Bandipur. And what about the national park? It's an in-situ conservation. Achcha? Able to follow? People who have marked A, let me clarify you. Okay, Harish, I will teach you now. See, you said Silent Valley is Bandipur. That will not be the answer, pa. Rhinoceros with Kaziranga, you are right. Tiger project, you have made tropical rainforest, tropical evergreen forest. No, that will not be there. You have confused that two alone. The other than that, the others are fine. You are able to follow, Harish? Yes. Oh, here comes the mathematics. I don't know how many people love maths or not. I am very aversive and allergic to maths. Yesterday you would have seen me on seeing a lizard, how I jumped, same with max also. But this is a very simple mathematic calculation, we will sort it out. So here with that species, that relationship, now we are going to make it. If log A is 4, Z is 0.3 and log C is 0.8, what is log S? 3.76, 100, 4.24, and then we have 4. Okay, so let me teach you how to make out with this. See, log S is there, which is equal to log C, acha, plus Z of log A. This equation I think you all will be knowing. So log S we are going to find out. So log C is how much? It is 0.8. Okay. What is Z here? 0.3. Log A is how much ma? It is into 4. Okay. So it is 0.8 plus that log of whatever. Into this 1.2, which will give you 2. So the answer is how much? 2. So here we are going to make with species richness and area that formula. Log S is equal to log C plus Z of log A. Okay. So where S is what? We are talking about the species richness. A is the area. Z is that slope line. And what about the C? That intercept line. So the answer is how much? 2. Yes. Very good. Rohan has given the answer. Very good. Yes. Yes, children. You all have given the right answer. Excellent. Now you learn, no? They'll ask like this only, simple only. You are going to substitute and make it out. It will not be like be weird like how you do in your max and all. Okay. Okay, coming to the next question. Which of the following statements is true? Biodiversity tends to increase as you get closer to the equator. Tropical regions of Earth contain very few of the world's land species. Coral reefs tends to be less biologically diverse than temperate deciduous forest. Cold climates have greater amounts of biodiversity than warm climates. So which of the statement is what? First thing, true. You're going to pick up a true statement here. So let me look in for your answers here. Which statement is true? Now see, children, when you're going to look into these answers, okay, let us see. Yes, somebody is giving the answer. 20, okay, for 20th question you are all giving. Let me see the answer here. Excellent, Sirisha. The biodiversity will always increase as you go near the equator. So they say that as you go near the poles, it will tend to decrease. So that is a true statement actually. Now, tropical regions of the earth, will they have very few land species? No. Okay, what about coral reefs will have less biologically diverse than temperate estuaries? No. What about the cold climate? The biodiversity will be more with the warmer climates than compared with the cold climates. So all these options will not fit into the statement with pertaining to biodiversity. Rather, the biodiversity will tend to increase as you move close towards the equator. Okay. Which of the following is the most important cause of animals and plants being driven to extinction? Okay, why the plants and animals, like, they are pushed to extinction? Achha, over-exploitation, alien species invasion, habitat loss and fragmentation, co-extinction. So what has made that extinction in plants and animals? What should be your answer? Yes, it's very easy. It cannot be over-exploitation or because of an alien species is coming up, like how you have in that Nile River, no, that fish, not like that. Or it is not because of something both coexisting in a place. So the answer is habitat loss. Either directly or indirectly, the humans, you know, whether knowingly or unknowingly, you can keep on adding like all these phrases. But what happens ultimately, there is either burning of the forest or cutting down of trees or whatever. Okay, or it could be like soil erosion or anything, or excessive rain, floods, everything. So what is happening? That habitat is getting lost. It is being fragmented, like. So what will happen to this flora and fauna which has been there for years together in an habitat? So definitely they are going to become extinct in a few more things. So that is where you have to know about it. So it is the habitat loss, not the alien species inversion. Actually, it is actually a check. Alien species invasion is actually, it's like a check for that biodiversity population number. Okay, it cannot be with that of leading to extinction. That cannot happen. So it is with the habitat loss and fragmentation. So that you need to know. Okay. Okay, the some students have put up that B, which cannot be the answer, I already told you. Okay, the Earth Summit, this is quite a direct question. The Earth Summit, which is a historic convention on biological diversity, was held in Johannesburg, South Africa, 2002, Rio de Janeiro, 1992, Kyoto, Japan, Montreal, Canada. So where is this Earth Summit that has taken place? Okay, it has actually taken place in the, I hope you all know the answer. Excellent student. Yes, I see Jeevita gave the answer. Excellent. So it is the Rio de Janeiro, which took place in Brazil, okay, from 3rd to 14th June 1992, nearly around some 100 countries, no, they do participated in it. Okay, so that is where that important with the Earth Summit. Okay, which of the following is an example of sacred lake? Dal Lake of Kashmir, Hechelor Palri Lake of Sikkim, Suraj Kand Lake of Haryana, Chilka Lake of Orissa, which is called the sacred lake. See, there are ways, you know, like men, you know, like what are the ways like you can make him not to disturb the flora fauna? One way is by talking in terms of beliefs, religious beliefs, taboos, ideas, ideologies, where they will not go near, disturb that. Like that, we have sacred lakes. Among this, which is the sacred lake? Yes? Yes, you are all right. It is the Hechelopari Lake, which is there, located in West Sikkim in India. So it is actually originally called as the Ka Kot Paldri, okay, which is actually there in the northeast, eastern part of the Sikkim also. Acha. So this is a sacred place for both Buddhist as well as Hindus. Okay, so that you need to know. It is not the Chilka Lake of Orissa, that is with that bird sanctuary, not with that. The I am asking about the sacred lake. Okay. Okay. IUCN Red List 2004 documents the extinction of dash species in the last dash years. 500, 300, 784, 500, 654, 500, 984, 300. So here they wanted you to know about the species numbers, come the years also. So what is the last, the 2004 documentation with the red list, they have given about the species. Okay, I think people are coming up with the answers. I think Harish has given the right answer. Excellent Harish. And yes, excellent Harish, Devanandam, Payam, Jeevita and all. So the answer is actually 784 species in the last 500 years ma. They say 784 species la, among that 338 are vertebrates. See how pathetic, you know, 338 are not disappeared just like that. See, 359 are invertebrates, 87 plants. So all these were the red list documentation showing the extinction of species. If they would have taken now 2020, we will know how much it would have increased. For the last 500 years, we are having this much extinction. So that is why they are planning with various strategies in terms of in situ, ex situ conservation, establishing bioreserve or hotspot or sacred lakes and groves, or it can be like ex situ in forms of botanical gardens, zoos, cryo preservation. So they want to protect these endangered species. See, all by looking into Jurassic Park only we know there is something dinosaur, honestly. But as years go, we won't know even there is something like what you call an Asiatic lion was there, or we won't be knowing is there a Nilgiri Thor was there. Like, things will start getting extinct like that. So that is why preserving the flora and fauna is the need of the hour. Okay, now here coming, we are going to match the column 1 with column 2. We are having the Nile perch in Lake Victoria. Okay, those fishes we are talking about. Narrowly utilitarian, main cause for biodiversity loss, hotspot. In column 2, they have given the obvious reasons for biodiversity conservation, habitat destruction, high endemism, alien species. So, we are going to match with this. Now, like somebody spoke with it, I will just give that example here. Nile perch in Lake Victoria is going to be with the alien species here. What about the narrowly utilitarian? The narrowly utilitarian is the obvious reason for the biodiversity conservation. Like, we have many utilitarian, right, where they narrowly or broadly utilitarian like that. And then the main cause for the biodiversity loss is what? The habitat destruction. And hotspots, I already said, it has got more species richness, okay, and it has also got that high endemism, that species that are more confined to that particular geographical area in that particular time, that we call it as the endemic species, okay, so like that. So this is the option, so this is your answer. So I think all students are just, yes, right from Shweta, Jeevita, Harish, Akshaya, Devanandan, Sri Tirisha, Rohan, all have given the right answers. So here I just wanted to talk about that alien species regarding that idea. See, alien species here, that is a concept here. So there is already fishes which has been present there in the in that particular Lake Victoria. But Nile perch inversion has come, which has brought to that extinction of that particular species which were dwelling there. So that is the concept of alien species. Okay, so it cannot be the one which we discussed in the contest with the previous slide there. Okay, the next one here, the sacred grooves, like how we have sacred lakes, okay, we have sacred grooves like those trees. Okay, they are especially useful in generating environmental awareness. Option B, preventing soil erosion, year-round flow of water in rivers, conserving rare and threatened species. So regarding the sacred grooves, see, sacred grooves is one form of biodiversity conservation which we all know. So people have those religious beliefs which I already told when we spoke about the sacred leaves, sacred lakes, I'm sorry. So the religious beliefs, you know, that will make them to construct, okay, in the form of what we call the sacred goose. So like that rare endangered threatened species, okay, we are on the, as well as those endemic species which are threatened there, they can be preserved like this in those places. So excellent. I see 3 Sirisha is giving up the answer. Okay. Everybody are quite near to the answer what you are able to understand, except one person who has said it is preventing the sea. Generating environmental awareness, we don't want. People, we are saying plant, all that we are conducting, drawing contest, everything, we are bringing their awareness. That is quite totally different. Preventing soil erosion is that with just planting, but what with sacred brew? Sacred brew, like we are inculcating a religious feeling in that. So it is not with soil erosion. Okay, that you need to understand. Or with that flow of water and all. Here, you want to conserve that species, so you give a small fear factor there in terms of religion or in terms of saying that that God is there or whatever. Like it's a place of worship. So people will not go touch or destroy. Like I hope you know that what you call that peepal tree and banyan tree and all, no? The Hindus, we go worship, right? So if you ask somebody to go cut, no, they'll say, oh, it's a place of worship. So they'll have that fear in them, right? They don't. So that is where it's a way in which, yeah, it is an in situ conservation of biodiversity. I hope you understood Devanandam Payam. Okay. So sacred brew is an example of in situ conservation of forest, the wildlife, where that rare threatened species like we are going to conserve. So this is a place like where we find those tribal communities there. They have their own religions, like in the form of their own culture and what you call, they'll have their own community and sort of worships and all. So here it is most undisturbed forest patches you will have, okay, with a highly degraded landscape and all that. So not a single branch will be allowed to cut from these forests. Like how I said, even those peepal trees and banyan, people will never touch that. The reason is that sacred goose. Same way here also, they will not allow you to touch a single branch, thinking that it's a place, it's a worship. So they will not allow to do so. And so many endemic species that were rare or extinct, no, that it can flourish here. Because nobody is going to enter that area. So whichever the species that is being locked in, they will be safe here. So that is the ideology behind the sacred groves. Okay. So sacred groves, like common, like you can see those, what you call the peepal. Peepal trees as well as the banyan, ficus trees. They are all like sacred groves. The medicinal plant Rafflesia vomitaria growing in Himalayan ranges shows variation in terms of potency and concentration of the chemical resperine that it produces. It is an example of species diversity, ecological diversity, genetic diversity, none of them. So here we are going to talk about the medicinal plant, the Rafflesia. I hope you all be knowing it. It is going to have the potent chemical in it, the resperine. But what is that? The example that we are going to quote here pertaining to which sort of diversity does this Rafflesia is made? Yes, excellent. Devanatham and Harish, you have given the right answers. Excellent. It is the genetic diversity. So what is you are going to talk with genetic diversity? Like they'll have different DNA, like you have the variations in all the species, right? Even though they are the same species, definitely the variation will be there. The variation in term of the potency, the concentration of that particular chemical will make it variant, right? So that we call it as the genetic diversity. The other good examples, like how this genetic diversity do come up? Probably because of recombination, random mating, mutations, etc. So we have like 50,000 different strains of rice, 1,000 different strains of mangoes in India. So all that exhibits what? The genetic diversity. So that you need to know. Okay, here coming up with the question, arrange the following in the decreasing order of their species diversity. Fishes, birds, reptiles, amphibian are there. Okay, how are we going to arrange in the decreasing order of their species diversity? Fishes, birds, reptiles, amphibian, or it is fishes, reptiles, birds, amphibian, reptiles, fishes, birds, amphibian, or it is amphibian, fishes, birds, and reptiles. What should be your answer? You are going to put them in the decreasing order of the species diversity. Yes? I'm waiting for your answers. What should be your answer? Yes, excellent. Some students started answering up. Yes, you are right. The answer is the fishes, then followed by birds, reptiles, and amphibians. See, the fishes are the oldest group of the vertebrates. So we have nearly around some 25,000 species of fishes on earth. What about the amphibians? They are descendant from those fishes. Okay, so the reptiles which have evolved from the amphibian ancestor, they are around some 6,300 species. And we know that birds have evolved from the reptiles. They are reptilian or the ancestors of those birds. So they are approximately, we have some 9,100 species of birds. So this is how we have been putting up in the decreasing order of their species diversity. Yes, Harish, Tirisha, everybody are giving the right answer. Next comes here a very interesting question. Comes here with the CHIPCO movement. The CHIPCO movement for conservation of forest was started in the year 1972 in North Kannada district, Silent Valley, Sudarbans, Gopeshwar. Where was this first started up? CHIPCO movement. I hope you will be knowing about CHIPCO movement, right? Yes. And previous to the CHIPCO movement, we have those Bishnois, those women. They belonging to that particular thing. They were very brave enough to fight against that king and that soldiers. And they don't want to cut down the trees. Even now in India, Bishnoi Amrita Devi Award is being awarded for people who are working for protecting the environment and nature. Okay. So like that with the CHIPCO movement. Yes. Yes, Devanayadam Payam has given the answer. But the exact answer is Gopeshwar. See, CHIPCO movement is actually meant for protecting the trees, ma. Like it is preservation of the environment, the habitat, the wildlife and all. You can see those ladies, you know, see how they make a circle and they just go stand around the trees. Okay, so this was started up in 1972 to 73 in Gopeshwar, in Chamoli, okay, where the trees were not allowed to cut by the village folk. They started hugging those trees. And then Rampur Pata, and then in 1974 in village Raini, led by Gaura Devi. First it was started by Amrita Devi, that Bishnoi group people. So this is where it started in Gopeshwar, and still this CHIPCO movement has brought that like a fire. It has brought so many people into the awareness about how it's important that to conserve forests rather than just cutting down for the humans and exploiting the nature. Okay, so that is how they are very important. So you can see the movement, it was led by Chandi Prasad Bhat of Gopeshwar and Sundar Lal Bahuguna of Teri Garhwal. So they were the pioneers, like, who were behind these CHIPCO movement. So that is with the day where we finish with the whole of 30 questions of 1 hour of session of the rapid quick revision in the biodiversity and conservation. So I think it would have been very interactive. Yes, I felt it is very interactive today. I enjoyed the session today. And same way, I think it would have been informative, like how to choose about when you get questions on these biodiversity topics. I hope it would have been useful. So see you soon, children, with another rapid session on the other topics. See you all soon. Okay. So, bye. Good night. Thank you. Yes, somebody is having, ma'am, give us some motivation or some guidelines for attending exam, ma'am. Yes, Harish, I think it's very important. See, because students, like I wanted you to know one thing, like you have put your heart and soul, you have prepared for your examination. So don't get demotivated yourself because you are attending all these revisions and you have been taking up the test which we have been conducting, right? So you know where you stand, okay? So just have that faith in yourself. First, you need to trust yourself. Unless you don't trust, you know, okay? Always your mind influences your body and body influences your mind. So when you are going to influence these things, your mind, okay? Otherwise, what will happen? Whatever you are prepared or your hard work will not come into thing. So I hope you children, like the way you were making up your answers and all that, as I see, you are all are prepared well. We know that you are going to par excel in your forthcoming exams. So don't worry. Please do attend the next sessions. Okay? In the end of the last session, I will give you some nice tips for you so that I'll finish the session little earlier and we can have some 5 to 10 minutes of how to take up the biology exam without fear. I will also discuss with you, okay, so that you can get good marks with flying colors. Okay, don't worry children, read well, sleep well, eat well, be safe. Good night. Somebody is asking in situ and ex situ conservation example, which we have seen in those 2 to 3 slides, no? I told that in situ and ex situ examples, ma'am. In situ example, like where you are using that same habitat, like wildlife sanctuaries or biosphere reserves. But when it comes to ex situ, it is something outside the habitat, like in terms of botanical gardens or seed banks, cryopreservation banks, they are all ex situ examples, okay? Priya, don't worry, okay, you can always see the video, there is nothing that you are going to miss. Please do attend tomorrow's session, okay, waiting to see you all, okay, thank you students, good night.